Hello, everybody. Curt Menefee with you from my home here in Southern California. Sit where you are and stay a while. That's kind of the world we're living in right now, as we all, obviously, most of us sitting in place by government mandate, but all of us just trying to do what we can to help prevent the spread of coronavirus and the COVID-19 form of the coronavirus. And so while you're doing that, I think a lot of people were just looking for a little bit of fun, maybe a sense of normalcy, if you will. So we're going to try and provide you with that here at Fox. We're calling this Fox Football Now. We'll join you over the coming weeks and talk a little football with some of our analysts and guests from the NFL on Fox and college football on Fox, and a lot of familiar faces that you know from the world of Fox Sports. In addition, Jay Glazer will have some of his friends from around the NFL. They'll be on Wednesday on all Fox digital platforms and on FS1 as well. But right now, it's time to bring in a couple of guys you know and love. Each and every Sunday, you see them on Fox NFL Sunday alongside me, Howie Long and Jimmy Johnson. Hello, boys. How you doing?
Yo, yo.
How you doing, Kurt?
Hey, Jimmy. You in a basement bar there? Where are you?
I'm in my office.
This reminds me of your first year when you did the show from the dock on your lounge chair.
Those were the days.
How you boys holding up just overall before we get to talking football? Start with you, Howie. Like, everything good with you and your family?
I think you really teed it up well. I mean, I think most folks are looking for some kind of distraction. Some sense of normalcy. And I think if you sit and look at the TV on the news every hour, it can be a real downer, and you can kind of overwhelm yourself with it. And it's great to have a little bit of an escape. And I think that's what we're hoping to do.
Everything good with you and the family down there, Jimmy?
Yeah, everything's great. I planted 6 coconut palms this morning on the beach and did some yard work. Just worn slap out right now. I tell you, digging those holes, that's not fun.
Well, Jimmy, you're probably about as close to people as you usually are this time of year in the off season. Anyway, so
no big deal. I'm a people person.
Exactly. Well, let's talk a little football here, because that's what we're here to do, and I think that people will enjoy it, as we said. And I think, really, if you look at what has happened in the NFL so far this off season, obviously the big story is free agency and Tom Brady going down to play with the Tampa Bay Buccaneers. Now that we are a couple weeks past it, you can kind of say, oh, okay, it makes sense. But when it happened, I know I was shocked. And I'll start with you, Howie. Were you surprised when it happened? And not only him leaving New England, but going to Tampa specifically.
No, I wasn't surprised. I mean, it's probably been one of the most talked about, you know, moves over the last 3 years. You know, one, Tom Brady's falling off a cliff. And two, you know, the chronicling the perceived kind of rift between Bill Belichick and Tom Brady. And I think, you know, a lot of that was kind of manufactured and people having to fill time on TV. I think some of it is probably real. I think both parties, meaning both Bill and Tom, I think are anxious to see if they can get it done without the other. I thought there were places that made sense. I thought Indianapolis maybe made sense. I thought the Chargers potentially made sense. I thought Tennessee potentially made sense. But Tampa Bay really does, when you sit and think about it after he made the move, it does make sense. They're loaded on offense. They've got a head coach and offensive coordinator in Leftwich who both appreciate and show appreciation for their quarterback. And I think it'll be interesting to see how they adapt that offense to fit Tom, because some of the things that Tom likes to do aren't necessarily some of the things that Bruce has always done. It's not a tight end driven offense. Tom likes to work the middle of the field. So it'll be interesting to see.
Jimmy, were you surprised?
Yeah, no, I'm not surprised. I kind of saw this coming here the last couple of years. And I think Brady coming to Tampa is just a big fit because he's got a great supporting cast. Howie, you talked about the offensive players, but they've got an outstanding defense as well. And so it'll be interesting to see how well Tampa plays this year with Brady protecting the ball. The thing that Jameis Winston wouldn't do is protect the football. And as far as the Patriots, as long as they got Bill Belichick, they're going to be, you know, in the picture. Obviously, they're going to have some struggles because they're going to have a lot of young players. They lost a lot of good players. In fact, the Dolphins signed quite a few of their players. But they'll still be good because they got Bill Belichick.
You know, I want to get to the Patriots and how they'll do in just a bit. But I guess I'll start with you, Jimmy, because the thing that intrigues me is that of all years for this to happen, now obviously this is not part of the plan, but the off seasons are going to be shortened no matter when they get back to playing football. We've already seen that with the, you know, draft and nobody being there and team workouts. So you go into a new team if you're Tom Brady. You're 43 years old. You've got a new offense that you've got to work with. It's an offseason where you can't get your team together like you normally do. Do you think that that will have a negative impact on him, or at his stage, this stage of his career, does that not matter?
I think it depends a little bit prior to the season. Really, you have to speed with those receivers in a couple of weeks. I mean, because you're talking about veteran players, about his quarterback all the time. And so Brady will be able to fit in there. And on top of that, he is going to fit the offense. You know, if anybody's going to be Tampa's players, and they're going to do what Tom Brady wants. And so if they get prior, they'll be ready to.
Howie, I think we've got some technical issues with Jimmy here, so I'll ask
you. Well, you know, to follow up on Jimmy's point, and I'm sure we'll get him back soon, I think Tom just brings so much to a locker room and to the way a team prepares, the way a team meets, the way a team practices. And I'm sure that in these really challenging times where, as you mentioned, it's an abbreviated offseason, and who does it hurt? Does it hurt the new coaches in the league? Does it hurt the quarterback, the young quarterback who's going somewhere else? And I don't think it hurts Tom. Tom has seen every conceivable defense there is and has run, although they run the same scheme for 20 years or close to 20 years, they've done it in variations. You know, when Randy Moss was there, they throwing it all over the yard. 2 years ago, it was Devlin, a 260-pound fullback, and they looked more like Dallas than they did New England. It was a lot of ISO plays, play-action pass. So Tom can do it any way he wants. And I think when Tom speaks in that huddle, in that meeting room, I think others will follow. And I'm sure that right now, if there's a way to communicate through whatever medium it is, Zoom or whatever the platform is, I'm sure they're doing it as much as they possibly can.
All right, I think we got Jimmy straightened out Curt, here. Go ahead.
Yeah, Curt, let me just apologize to the viewers because they've got to understand I live in the Florida Keys, and I've got a coffee can and a wire out to a computer about 10 miles away. And so sometimes that coffee can doesn't get the reception, you know, that you might get us in the city.
Well, get on that 50-foot boat of yours and drive down to where they have better Wi-Fi.
I guarantee you, he doesn't enter that coffee can distance in between where he is now. Let me ask you this, Jimmy. Another intriguing thing here about, I think Brady goes from maybe the easiest division in football when he was with New England and the AFC East year in and year out. So you could argue the toughest division in football right now. You got New Orleans, and they loaded up. You got Carolina, and I don't think they're going to be a write-off like people think. Also, you've got the Atlanta Falcons, who the second half of the season looked like a team I think people thought. That's a really tough division he's got to play in now just to make the playoffs.
Yeah, you're exactly right. You know, they can have a great football team and still maybe only win, you know, 10, 11 ball games. And I think that division is going to be exciting to watch all year long. And like you say, Carolina, with a new coaching staff, you know, with some of the players that they have picked up, Carolina's not going to be a pushover. And you know New Orleans with Breeze is going to be a great team. You know Atlanta, the talent they have. It's going to be maybe the best division in all of football.
Howard, yeah, you got to take a quick break here.
Expanding the playoffs.
Go ahead, Rad. Yeah.
Expanding the playoffs.
By getting seven teams in each conference.
Yeah.
Yeah, you know, we'll help.
I think that helps a lot. I like having Tom Brady. Here, the only question you have with Tom Brady, and I don't think there's been a drop off that people have kind of, you know, been going with for the last couple of years. I think it's a drop off in personnel up there in New England. But I think Tom Brady, the only question I have for Tom is he's 43, and if something happens during the course of the year, it's more difficult to come back at 43 than it is at 38 or 37.
All right, this is tough, Howie. In 15 seconds, how do you think New England does without Brady, short and long term?
I will. It's like an echo chamber. Is Bill Belichick the coach?
Yeah.
Then I think the Patriots are going to be fine. It's going to be a different looking Patriots. Probably win game 16-13, good defense, run the football, protect the ball, more movement at quarterback. It'll look different.
All right. Well, Brady's the big change at quarterback going on around the National Football League. He's not the only change. We talked about Teddy Bridgewater's there in the NFC South. He replaces in Carolina Cam Newton. Where will Cam Newton go? We will examine that and talk a whole lot more about what has happened so far in this NFL offseason. Joel Klatt and Urban Meyer will join us as well as we talk college football and the draft. Please stick around. There's much more to come on this home version of Fox Football Now. All right, everybody. Thanks for joining us for our little get-together. Curt Menefee along with Howie Long, Jimmy Johnson, Joel Klatt, and Urban Meyer will join us in just a bit as we talk football right here on what we're calling Fox Football Now, but it's really just a get-together among friends here in the offseason. And, you know, Howie and Jimmy, we were talking really about the free agency moves of Tom Brady specifically last segment. Let's get into the big picture here. And you look at free agency around the NFL, and it really has focused on the quarterbacks maybe more this offseason than ever before. One guy who hasn't gone anywhere and won't go anywhere, Jimmy, is Dak Prescott. The Cowboys franchise tendered him. It'd be about $27 million if he signs it. But one, do you think that that's the long-term move? Do you think that this is just on hold to get him there? Or do you think this is one of those, let's see him prove it one more time?
I think that they'll get the deal done. I actually think it's a non-story. I mean, you know, really, because they're going to hammer out a contract. They will eventually come to a number that they're going to be happy with, the Cowboys are going to be happy with, and Dak's going to be happy with. You know, so, again, I think it's a non-story. You know, Dak Prescott will be the quarterback for the Dallas Cowboys. And not only will he be the quarterback for the Dallas Cowboys this year, he'll be the quarterback for the Dallas Cowboys for many years to come. They'll get a contract done.
Howie, do you think it's a wait-and-see thing one more time or agree with Jimmy?
No, I agree with Jimmy. I think the big question becomes, you know, typically you would say, well, what numbers do we work off of? Well, maybe we work off the Wentz number and the Goff number, but we've got the new CBA and, you know, the numbers are going to go up. And
exactly.
I think Dak and his representation are probably factoring that in. I agree with Jimmy. I think they have to get a deal done. Dak has kind of punched every box there is in terms of his performance down there. And, you know, they're a talented group. I think it's a team that is poised to make a run. The only question becomes, how do you get the quarterback in place? And, you know, you just signed the wide receiver Cooper for $100 million, I don't know, 60-something guaranteed. What's Dak's guarantee going to look like? That's the big question. What will the contract look like? It will probably set the market.
Well, I think it probably should. I mean, you look at it, they are stacked up to go now. They not only signed Cooper, they signed Gerald McCoy this offseason. You know, and they go out there. They did lose Byron Jones, but, I mean, they're committing money to win now. This is not about 2 or 3 years from now, and it's so hard. If you have a quarterback, you got to try and keep them because they're too hard to find. And this is a guy who's never missed a start as a fourth-round pick, 40-24 overall. So, I mean, I agree.
Rock solid. You
know, yeah. Great in the community, great in the locker room, that kind of guy. When you find him, again, it's too hard to let those guys go. But looking at other teams, and I'll start with you here on the Carolina Panthers and Cam Newton. You know, I guess Jameis Winston's kind of in the same boat. They're probably the two biggest names that are still out there at quarterback. We saw what Jameis did last year, led the league in passing, but also led the league in interceptions. Cam, we're at that stage of his career where we're kind of wondering, who is he? Do you think that's the reason he hasn't been – either traded for or signed just yet?
I think, sure, you know, one. Go ahead, Jimmy.
Well, I just think the big question here is he healthy?
Yeah, right.
How would you know this? You know, once a player starts having injuries, the percentage of those injuries go up each particular year. And he's had all kinds of, ankle, leg, and so, I think the injury thing is a big question. If he is 100% healthy, he's as good as any quarterback in this league if he's 100% healthy. But, I don't know if he's healthy.
And it kind of goes back, Howie, too, that right now the teams, they can't have their own doctors give a guy a physical because of the travel restrictions. So everybody has to kind of guess about health right now.
Well, I think Carolina didn't do many favors by releasing him when they did. That's one. Two, I think everyone is waiting to see him. People just don't know. He's got the Liz Frank injury with the foot. He's had the shoulder worked on. And we talked about it. There are a lot of quarterbacks in the league, like, for example, the guy in Arizona, Murray, and Russell up in Seattle, which have kind of redefined what we're looking for in quarterbacks. They're pocket quarterbacks, but they can also pick it up and move it. And, they get down very quick. They're like middle infielders. It's like sliding or picking up a ground ball. For Cam is a big man, and Cam cannot get down quickly. And Cam has, I don't know whether it's he plays like a running back a lot of times at 6'5", 250, and there's a lot of collisions. And those collisions pile up. And as Jimmy mentioned, once you start having those kinds of injuries, it's difficult to kind of for a team right now to say, well, that's the direction we're going to go in. We think we can get 3-4 solid years out of Cam, and he could be our franchise quarterback. It's really a guessing game right now as to where he is physically.
All right, so wherever Cam ends up, we'll find out whether he's a starter or backup. We know the same thing with Jameis Winston, probably going to be a backup somewhere, but maybe there's someone who'll give him a chance to start.
That's amazing. That's amazing.
Lead the league in passing, and you don't have a job 2 months later.
Are but you know what? He,
at that? Oh, he, it's a situation.
He's the same exact guy he was coming out of college. Dynamic talent, throws for a ton of yards, a ton of touchdowns, on a very talented team. But the turnovers, it piles up, and it's kind of prophetic. It ends up kind of being a self-fulfilling prophecy.
And it's almost like
the other thing,
you just said about Brady coming to Tampa, if you can just cut down on the turnovers, it's not who makes the most good plays, as you like to say, but the fewest mistakes.
And the thing about it, Curt, Jameis has had half a dozen coaches trying to get him out of that. So it's not like, okay, here comes a new coach and we'll be able to correct him. Bruce Arians couldn't correct him. Dirk Cutter, he couldn't correct him. He's had other coaches that have tried to get him out of that. And, for some reason, he still wants to force the ball down the field. And don't overlook this too. He had great receivers, So he was willing just to throw it up on a 50-50 ball because his receiver would get it. Well, he's not going to be able to do that somewhere else. So his turnovers might even be more at the new place.
Good point.
And how old is he? What is he, 26?
27 by the time the season starts,
Ooh.
I think. I didn't look it up to be exact.
Unbelievable.
And so he's still young.
Unbelievable.
Hey, real quick here, big picture with free agency so far. We haven't gotten to the draft yet. Anybody, I want each one of you to give me like a team that you've seen so far whose moves you've liked. Whether it's Tampa, obviously getting Brady is a big thing. But Carolina, I think, has gotten a couple of guys. New Orleans has gotten a couple of guys. The Miami Dolphins have done well. Some of these teams have gone out there. Anybody catch your eye with the moves they made so far in the offseason? Jimmy, go first.
Well, there's two teams. Number one, I think the Miami Dolphins will be legitimate this year. Brian Flores has really done an outstanding job, with nothing last year. And with the players they have picked up, plus with what they're going to be able to bring in with the draft, they'll be a legitimate football team this year. Now, the other one, the New Orleans Saints, they have been close the last couple of years. Yeah, I just think this is the year the New Orleans Saints says, okay, let's get over the hump.
I think Calais Campbell going to Baltimore is just, you know, it adds a to me, a, no pun intended, a big piece for them. I think DeForest Buckner going to Indianapolis, and it remains to be seen whether Philip Rivers has something still in the tank, but it's obvious that they're planning on winning right now, and that was one of the places where that Brady was rumored to be going to. I would say DeAndre Hopkins, to add him to what they have there, Arizona. Yeah, you talk about division. You talk about divisions. That division out there is pretty darn good. And then it's interesting, yeah. Jimmy, six games into the season this past year when Miami was just dealing everybody. People are saying they're crazy. They're throwing the season away. They're gonna go 0-16. They want to pick number one, and then they kind of built it up in the second half of the year, and they finished off strong. And if you go back and think about turnarounds, they usually start with the end of the season the previous year.
Yep, they finished 5-4 in the regular season, and we talked about how they got the fifth pick in the draft right now and loaded up on free agency. They're going to be a team to watch certainly next season. Howie, we got to let you go.
All right, partner.
Another room in your house.
You got see Jimmy.
I'm going to the kitchen.
And you got some hot pot down there. All right.
Love you, brother. We'll see you later. All right, Howie's going to disappear for a little bit. Jimmy's going to stay with us. Urban Meyer will join us as well as we talk about the draft. And really, how do you go about a draft, particularly in this day and age with all that we're sitting right here and going through? Much more as we continue right here on Fox Football Now. Stick around. Heisman Trophy winner Joe Burrow expected to be the top pick in this year's draft, at least by most people. And with the draft only 3 weeks away, we are joined by Coach Urban Meyer of Fox Big Noon Kickoff and our lead college football analyst Joel Klatt. Hello, boys. How you doing?
Doing fantastic. Good to see you.
Hopefully all well with you and the family, both of you, Coach?
Yes.
All healthy, all good. Yeah, so far so good.
All right, good. Well, let's talk a little football here, and we mentioned the NFL draft is just about 3 weeks away here. But this is a different one, you know, Joel, than obviously most of we're used to. You know, we're used to seeing team visits and pro workout days. How does dealing with, as the entire nation is, the coronavirus outbreak impacted the NFL draft, particularly for guys that either didn't go to the combine or didn't have good combine workouts?
Yeah, from a player perspective, I think this really basketball. And what it does is all of the pressure back onto what you already put onto tape during the course of the fall. So there's no amount of time to now make up ground. In particular, guys that are injured that need to prove that they're healthy, I think it puts them behind the eight ball. And just think about it from a numbers perspective, guys. 30 players were drafted last year that did not go to the NFL scouting combine. I would be shocked if we had anywhere near that, and then mainly, in main part, due to the fact that teams are going to struggle getting medical information for some of these guys, if not all of these guys, in
Coach?
Yeah, the NFL Combine, what happens, and it's really changed over the years, but the minute a player is done with his last bowl game, they sign with an agency, and the agency basically takes them and prepares them for the combine. They do the drill, footwork, you know, whatever it be, the 40-yard dash, the vertical jump, the bench press, and exactly the same drills they do. I watched it for many, many years. But then also they put them with these interview experts that teach them how to interview well. And if there is a player issue, then how to, you know, maybe, you know, somehow skip past that hard question. That's why the coaches and the GMs really love pro days, because that's on campus. You saturate the really good organization, saturate yourself. There's been times where we'd have four or five coaches from one pro franchise in, the GM, and they would go top to bottom, inside out, upside down. You'd spend time with a strength coach, a trainer, the position coach, and those are the great organizations. You know, they come in, and now you can see why they draft so well, and they have a set criteria, which I'm going to talk to Coach Johnson about a little later, but a set criteria that they're looking for. And, you know, when I was a young coach just starting, I didn't realize that. As I, you know, just through the years at Florida and Ohio State, sitting in with watching the teams that do well on draft day and watch the other ones that don't, it's because it's very simple. As Joel said, it's you're going to work real hard, good things are going to happen. If you don't work real hard at it and you're getting your information from somewhere, that's what's really going to miss. I've talked to a bunch of NFL guys in the last 2 weeks. Some of them are in a panic because they use those pro days. That's where they really get the information. The combine, good, but the combine's a meat market. It's chaos. If you've ever been to the combine, it's, you know, there's a couple hundred athletes there. There's coaches. There's all kinds of craziness going on. The best information and intel goes on campus.
It is amazing, Joel. You can sit down probably 2 or 3 minutes with a guy. I think most people, and you get a good sense if you can do that in person, that you can't really see by watching him on film or those kind of things, just about who he is and his background, those kind of things. When you look at that from a big picture standpoint, I don't think Tua Tagovailoa, I know I was going to have a hard time saying that, but I don't think there's a person who will say a bad thing about him as a kid. I mean, he seems to be
right,
the perfect young man. But when you look at this draft, because of his injury history, might the way the scenario plays out impact him maybe more because he can't really sell himself one-on-one like a lot of other people have or will be able to, or would normally be able to do, is what I wanted to say. And he's coming off the injury history and the surgery.
There's no doubt. And just to piggyback on what Coach was saying, you know, those on-campus visits, and even when you're able to bring a prospect to your facility as an NFL franchise, they use that to get information, yes, certainly, but also to check off red flags, whether it's a medical red flag, whether it's a personality red flag. And now anybody that has one of those red flags from a personnel standpoint, it's going to be harder for them to get over that. So you're going to see guys slide in the draft that maybe wouldn't have slid in years past because of the situation that we're in. Then the thing that I just wanted to make note of is that you're going to see organizations that trust their scouting department. Because there are a lot of organizations, and Coach knows these ones, that are out there even in the fall, and their scouts are talking with coaches, they're on the campuses, and they're getting their information early. Some organizations wait until late, and they do it now during the draft process. But now I'm going to see these organizations that really trust their scouting department, have that philosophy that Coach was talking about, and I think those are the ones that are going to rise to the top in a draft like this.
You know, Coach, I wanted you to play scout here for a little bit, because if you look at the draft, the way it's stacked up right now, and again, it's a different world than we normally are used to. But you look at the top three picks, and I think probably the three best prospects, even if they don't go 1, 2, 3, are guys that you recruited. Joe Burrow, who started out at Ohio State and then went down to LSU winning the Heisman Trophy. Chase Young, a lot of people expect him to go 2 to Washington. And then the cornerback, Jeff Okuda. Just give us a little bit of insight about those guys.
Well, like I told you, we're going to discuss this with Coach Jimmy Johnson a little bit, but something I learned from Bill Belichick is over the years, he would come in and spend an inordinate amount of time with me about not just the first rounder, but the free agent. He'd ask me question after question. He'd send me a list in a text message and say, I need to see these 5 guys, these 8 guys. And those kids knew exactly beyond time. He'd sit down and talk to him. He'd talk to me about every one of them, never mentioning the vertical jump, 40-yard dash, or height, weight, but if they fit the criteria. And something that we developed at Ohio State, the recruiting misses that we had at Ohio State were almost non-existent. And it was because we came up with very set criteria, and I'll give them to you. Number one, is he a competitive maniac? Elite competitor, number one. Number two, is he tough? And I mean, pain versus injury tough. What's the difference between pain and injury? A guy that doesn't come off the field. Number three, is he a leader? Does he raise the level of play of those around him? Number four, is he intelligent? Can he operate? Football is a very complex game. And number five, can he adapt? That means if he's a quarterback when a play is broken down, can he adapt? Because a tailback, the hole's not there, can he do something? You know, same thing on defense. Is he an adaptable player? And you can do different things with him. So I would list those five characteristics above our signing board, And we could not, I would not allow a coach to put a name on that board unless they fit that five criteria. Now, every once in a while, you'd have that one outsider. As Bill Belichick would say, it's a peripheral player, a player that doesn't quite fit that, but he's that good. You know, he's a 10-100. He's got some freakish skill set. And if you have a very strong core, and I'm holding my hands the way he used to do that with me, if you have a strong core, you can take one or two of those. If you don't have a strong core, stay away from those. And it's just, once again, the system that they had in place, it taught us a lot. That's exactly what I kind of went to as I grew up in the coaching profession. And near the end of Florida and certainly at Ohio State, we had a very set criteria. And if we followed the criteria, you didn't make a recruiting mistake.
And those three guys fall into that criteria?
Oh, yeah. You look at all three of them, and the number one thing they are is they're maniac competitors. Chase Young, Okuda, and even Joe Burrow. Joe Burrow's skill set wasn't as advanced because he was an all-state basketball player. But as far as fitting all five of those qualities, all five are right perfect to a T. And obviously Joe went on and had two great years at LSU, one exceptional year. But he certainly fit that criteria.
All right, Coach, you're going to stick around and join Jimmy Johnson, a little Coach's Corner, to talk more about the draft. Joel, we're going to let you go for just a bit, but we're going to have you back to answer some fan questions. Before you go, though, Urban did the scouting on the players. I want you to take a look at that goatee and give me a scouting report on Urban's goatee. What do you think?
Yeah, listen, I don't know if that's going to make the cut. We're going to need a little bit more clean when we come on the air. It's the quarantine. The
goal might be off.
There you go. Hey, well, we all had the quarantine beard for a while. I finally shaved mine off. So we got the gray hair still going. Coach, stick around. We're going to have Coach Johnson join you in just a bit. Joel, don't go away too far because we got more to talk with you as we continue here on Fox Football Now. All right, back here hanging out with the fellas. Urban Meyer is still with us. Jimmy Johnson rejoins us. Jimmy, I'm going to sit back here because I want you guys just to talk about, we hit on the draft a little bit earlier with Urban and specifics of it, but just the philosophy, you've seen it from both sides, about how you go about approaching the draft, and then maybe this year, obviously, it's a little bit different without the one-on-one face-to-face time, but just your philosophy, and I want to hear you and Coach Meyer go back and forth just about your take on it.
Your phone's got to be ringing off the wall, Urban, because, you know, the big thing for me, you know, people ask me, like, for instance, you know, would you take Tua, would you trade up for Burrows? Would you do all this? I said, you know, the biggest thing for me, I wanted to build a player. You know, I wanted to be able to sit down. That's why the interviews at the combine, that was more important than watching them run a 40 dash. And I got so much information with my strength coach calling the college strength coach, talking to them. You know, because a lot of times, if you talk to a coach that you don't know, he's going to sell his player. But when my strength coach talked to the strength coach, they were on the same level. Then I'd have my trainer call the college's trainer, talk, well, you know, how is he there? You know, is he continually in the training room? Is he hurt? And when he's in the training room, is he a real positive attitude type of guy? And the other thing, especially with coaches that I knew, I was on the phone saying, tell me, how good a player is this? I'll give you a quick story. Back many, many years ago when I was coaching at Wichita State back in the 60s, Colorado did as good a job of recruiting talent as anybody in the country. And I said, well, what did they do? Did they go to watch them play? And they said, no. They talked to all the opposing coaches of teams. They said, who's the best player that you played against? You know, and then they would get a ranking of these players by really getting information from the different high school coaches. And that's how they recruited, and they brought in great talent. It gets down to performance. Sometimes when you scout these players, you go height, weight, speed, you know, quickness, on and on and on. You forget about, hey, how good a player is he? That's what the coach will tell you.
Well, I feel very strong about this, Curt, and Coach Johnson, that it's amazing that when you're hired as a head football coach, two things you have to do. Number one is develop a culture and implement a culture. Number two, it's called talent acquisition. And in college, it's recruiting and development. In the NFL, it's drafting and free agency, et cetera, and development. And when I was a young coach, I didn't have set criteria when I first started off. And then a guy named Bill Belichick would come visit with me every year. And his visit wasn't a quick drive-by. It was, he was in my office for 3 to 4 hours. He would meet with every player. He would ask me questions. Not one time would it be, how fast is he, or how tall is he, or what's his vertical jump? He would ask me if he fits the criteria of a New England Patriot. I knew exactly what it was. It was an intense competitor, a toughness, and all the things that he believes in, because he would share that with me constantly. And I changed my way of recruiting. And when I was at Florida, I never really, you know, if you ran fast, you had a high vertical jump, we signed you. I wanted the fastest team in America. And then I just started learning, and by the way, we did. But yeah. I just learned along the way that players have to fit your criteria. And I learned that from Coach Belichick and the other great coaches, that there's no secret. I mean, it's not a secret, the teams that win every year. How about this for a stat, Coach Johnson, that there's teams that lose every year that have better players on paper than the New England Patriots, because they draft ahead of them every year, so they must. But they never, there's also some of the programs or franchises that really struggle, that I couldn't tell you who's in their personnel department. I never talk to their coach. I never do the things that you said. This, imagine me going out and recruiting and not talking to the high school coach. So I don't know.
Right.
I'm sure they're gathering. I'm sure they're gathering information. I'm sure they're getting it from someone. But the way I was brought up in the business, you always go right to the source, and that's the head football coach, whether it be high school, whether it be in college, and go, like you said, I want to know, tell me what he's like when he's hurt. I want to know, what's he like on a Wednesday practice? Is he going to tap out all the time? What's he like on fourth down? What's he like in the toughest situations? And do they fit our criteria? I can tell you this, I don't think some NFL teams have criteria. Because I don't know who they are.
Not to interrupt you here, but I think it's a great story. Are you saying that when you had players, because whether it's a Florida or Ohio State, you had guys that were going high in the draft, but that you didn't hear from teams that were drafting high, that were asking you all the time? Not every team called you?
Curt, if I told you a story, you wouldn't be shocked, because there's a reason why certain programs just don't win very often. And that's because I never heard from them. Now, the ones that happen to win a lot, and the happens that do a good job, and almost wear you out. You know, our strength coach, we have the best strength coach, Coach Marotti. And Ryan Day and I talked about this. There's a draft come up, and he has not been approached by a bunch of teams. And we just kind of laugh. You're like, you got to be kidding me. What are you doing? You know,
so like who?
If you want to get,
you're out of the coaching game now. You can tell names, or at least organizations. Probably those people aren't there anymore. So when you were at Florida or Ohio State, and you had a big name guy, and teams were drafting early in the draft, you thought, okay, I know they're going to hit me up. You never heard from. Give me a couple of examples, or at least some players that you thought people would.
I'm not going to give names and coaches, but and teams. They're the ones that don't win, and they're probably not going to win next year, and they're not going to win the year after. I mean, it's just there's a pattern there that I've never really had time to look into it, but this year I kind of spent some time studying the NFL and studying, talking to a bunch of our former players, and just tell me about the culture of the organization. And boy, oh boy, I mean, it's really the same as college. It's the same as corporate America. You get these strong cultures with strong leaders inside that culture, you win. And it's amazing. I've had my players go in the top 5 to top 10 picks in the draft. And you're talking about generational money, and I didn't get a phone call.
Story done. Jimmy, go work on that coffee can. We appreciate you, brother.
Okay.
Always good to hear from you. Coach Meyer, thank you so much for the time as well. Great hearing stories. I love
Thanks,
it.
Kirk.
And you got to give me some names next time, all right? At least send me an email. We'll talk to you later, guys. Thanks a lot. All right, back to wrap things up here on Fox Football Now. Joel Klatt, some of your questions right after this. All right, Joel Klatt rejoins us to wrap up this edition of Fox Football Now with your questions submitted on social media. And Joel, the very first one is very simple. Who will have the more successful pro career, Tua or Joe Burrow?
All right, I got to go with Joe Burrow because the question marks the injuries to Tua. I mean, those are going to be the full season yet, even in the college level, whereas Joe Burrow We saw him have maybe the single greatest college football season a quarterback has ever had last year for LSU. And I'll also add the fact that he took a team that was constantly underachieving in LSU, and he took them over the top, and he got them to that national championship, which is what he's going to have to do with Cincinnati, because, you, as you know, that's a tough fit in Cincinnati. Yeah. They haven't had a lot of success there.
Guy who's used to doing more with less, at least thus far in his career, at the collegiate level, now trying to do it at the pro level. All right, question number two. We'll talk about a team trying to turn it around. San Francisco, 4 wins 2 years ago in the Super Bowl last year, but then they lose Emmanuel Sanders in free agency this offseason. So the question is, do you see the 49ers addressing the need for a wide receiver, or should they try to replace DeForest Buckner, the defensive lineman they lost to the Colts, with their 13th overall draft pick that they got from the
Colts? I think that they needed to do – yeah, that's right. And they needed to do two things. They needed ammunition in the draft, which now they've been able to do with more picks, in particular in this first round, and they need to get an outside threat. And in the middle of that first round, Kurt, they've got three amazing receivers that potentially get Jerry Jeudy, C.D. Lamb from Oklahoma, Henry Ruggs from Alabama. Any one of these three guys is a game changer, and I think a guy that they need to target in that first round and ultimately select. And it wouldn't shock me at all if they went wide receiver again later in the draft as well, because it's a very deep draft at that position group.
All right, final question. And this one comes from our colleague at Fox, Jenny Taft. And she also worked with us at the XFL. She says, miss working with you guys. We miss you too, Jenny. Look, her question is simple. What rule changes do you like, if any, you think might be considered for college football or the NFL that we saw happen over in the XFL?
Well, Kurt, I mean, I was so sad that that season got cut down because I was having such a great time with you calling those games. About that kickoff rule is a no-brainer to make the game first, to keep that exciting play in the game. The kickoff rule would be first and foremost. And then two others that I think maybe down the list. I think the replay official and the television getting in there with the audio and listening to the officials talk about the replay and how they're coming about their decision. And then the last thing is, I'd really love to see, in particular, college football adopt some of these speedy clock rules outside of the last 2 minutes of each half so that we can start the game under 4 hours. And trust me, that's selfish because I got to make those flights on Saturday, you know?
Well, we got to wrap this up. The one thing I do agree, though, the transparency of the booth is the thing I think is not just going to come to the NFL or college football. I think all sports are going to do it. Like we saw Mike Pereira change the way officiating was done in television. I think the same thing is going to happen there with the replay booth. Brother, I miss being you on the road. We will try and do this on Mondays here on Fox from time to time. Good to see you always.
You got it.
All right, you at home, the rest of you, we will catch you again each Monday here with Fox Football Now. Don't forget on Wednesday, Jay Glazer on all our digital platforms and FS1 will be hanging out with his friends. Make sure you check that out because you know that's going to be different than everything else you see anywhere else. We will catch you for more Fox Football Now next Monday. Gotta go. Bye.